Counselor, obviously the proposals before us from the executive were prompted by a number of notable grand jury decisions. Is it the governor's position that those grand jury decisions were wrong?
The governor has not taken a position on those decisions, and that's, I think when you look at the proposal, I would advise to look at the proposal through that prism. The problem that I think the governor is faced with is we have a decision, at least in the Eric Garner case, that many have concluded is wrong, in part because there is a video, and the public has viewed the video. But the problem is the public was not a part of the grand jury process. No one knows whether or not the instructions were proper or not. No one knows whether or not there was a problem with specific grand jurors. And I think that is, I think, the tension that we're trying to resolve here. The governor is not opining on those cases, in part because he doesn't have sufficient information.
Well, if the governor did not disagree with those decisions, why would we even have proposals for so-called reforms?
Because there is...
Because the grand jury system has been the process has been the same for a long time in this country, and now all of a sudden we have these radical reforms. So one can only imply that it is because the governor believes that the grand jury decision in that case and others was wrong. And I'm asking, based upon what would the governor believe that those decisions were wrong?
The governor recognizes that there is a perceived, or in some instances actual, lack of trust in the system. I think we can agree to disagree on several cases, whether or not we agree with the outcome in the Garner case or in the Ferguson case. And I think that's, from our perspective, beside the point. What we're focused on is that New Yorkers, to a large degree, depending on race or ethnicity or location or geographic, or residency, I should say, may have lost trust in the criminal justice system. And what we're seeking to do with this proposal is provide greater transparency and accountability. We are not changing the grand jury system per se, but instead allowing the governor to make an informed decision when he's asked to appoint.
I would have to disagree.
Special prosecutor.
You are suggesting that we've changed the grand jury system. So part of the American way from its beginning has been the notion that we will have a jury of peers and that there's a presumption of innocence. And so what you're saying now, though, is when we disagree with a decision, that we're going to have politics enter the equation. We're going to have someone other than the grand jury and a jury of the peers. We're going to have, for instance, a governor then look at the evidence that was part of the grand jury. So tell me how that does not fundamentally change the grand jury procedure when you're dealing with certain cases where you disagree. Because my understanding is only when a governor, and two-part question. In this case, the governor happens to be a lawyer. So you might argue that the governor has the expertise to actually look at what happened in the grand jury and make some type of legal determination or opinion. There is no requirement that a governor be a lawyer. So really what's happening here is we're inserting, aren't we, politics into the situation, that any governor who disagrees with a grand jury can then trigger this new procedure that you're suggesting.
Well, Senator Lanza, we actually may have spoken about this before you walked in, so I'll just briefly...
I'm sorry, there are lots of budget hearings going on.
Yeah, I know. So I'll briefly restate, I think, just the framework. Under Executive Law 63-2 and 63-3, current law, the governor can appoint a special prosecutor where the district attorney fails to prosecute or is unable to prosecute. Very broad statute. So when you think about, and your point of, regarding politics...
I was here, by the way, when you said that.
Oh, okay. You know, right now, the governor could appoint a special prosecutor in many cases simply because he believes that the district attorney was unable to prosecute, or because the victims are unable to or unwilling to cooperate with the DA, or because the DA makes a public statement that suggests that they're unwilling to effectively prosecute the case. So that standard is not being affected at all. Instead, what we're doing, again, is informing the process so that when the governor is asked or has to make a determination on his own whether or not it's appropriate to appoint a special prosecutor, he does so in an informed way. He has no idea what happened in the grand jury room. We don't have the grand jury minutes, we don't have the instructions, we don't have the charges.
So isn't that the same as saying that whenever a governor disagrees with a grand jury decision, the governor will decide, for whatever reason, usually politics, because that's what drives the executive and the legislative branch. That's how our system is based. So wouldn't the case be that whenever a governor disagrees with a decision, that's when the governor, under this suggestion, would step in and overturn, in effect, that decision, or attempt to overturn that decision? And isn't that contrary to everything we believe in as Americans, where we wanted to separate the procedure regarding criminal prosecutions from politics? Would we not be doing precisely the opposite of what we're supposed to be doing as Americans?
Well, I actually respectfully disagree on that, Senator, because I think the focus here, again, is informing the process as opposed to changing existing law. Existing law is governor can appoint a special prosecutor tomorrow in many cases. And the standard, again, is very broad. That is not being affected in any way. So the question of whether or not the governor is second-guessing the grand jury, we tend to think the governor is actually informing his determination as to whether or not to appoint a special prosecutor, because the contrary, which is under the existing framework, if he were to make a decision tomorrow, it's really going to be based on what he read in the New York Post or what he read in the New York Times.
Which would make for an irresponsible decision. So,
right.
But what you're saying now is that the governor would like to look at the testimony and the proceedings of the grand jury and then make his own political decision as to whether or not the right or wrong thing happened.
I don't think it's a political decision. I think it's a legal one, because the standard is outlined not only in 63.2 and 3, but it's also outlined in the Article 7.
It's the grand jurors that, for instance, on Staten Island, so those members from the community, mm-hmm. those peers of that defendant, that accused, is there any suggestion that they, all those members, ignored the law?
No, not at all.
Is there any suggestion that any of them acted based upon any bias?
No.
So why these radical suggestions to change what has been the most respected criminal process in the entire world? Mm-hmm. Why now?
Again, I think because there is a perceived lack of trust, or an actual lack of trust, by many community members. And I think in this day and age, where we have information and documentation that's provided to the public outside of the grand jury process, and there is, in some instances, a lack of alignment, or at least a perceived lack of alignment, I should say, between the actual outcome and what's publicly available, we need more information to assess whether or not it's appropriate, in certain instances, to appoint someone else to review that process. I think if we ignore that, what we do is further erode the public's trust in the system. The public currently, and I think when you look at the polls, the public currently does not have the trust in the system that we would like the public to have. And this proposal will hopefully engender trust in the system, but also provide greater accountability.
Well, we're just gonna have to leave off disagreeing. You know, there was a time when I was a prosecutor in Manhattan, there was a time when there was a perception within the public that too many criminals were getting off, if mm-hmm. you will,
absolutely,
and escaping conviction. And there was talk about the technicalities that exist in our criminal justice system. I tell you, those protections are the greatest the world has ever known, and part and parcel of the American way. There was no rush to judgment then to say we're going to eliminate the presumption of innocence because we feel too many guilty people are getting away with committing crimes. And in the same way, we should not be engaging in knee-jerk reactions now to change a tried and true process that makes it difficult. And while it was frustrating to me as a prosecutor then, I wouldn't want to live in any other country except ours, where we make it difficult for the king, the queen, the executive, to decide based upon politics when someone is guilty and when someone isn't.